You know, it's overwhelming when you're in the Lord's presence and you open up your heart to Him and you cry out because you want to be like Him. We as human beings don't always get things right. We always make mistakes. But the key factor is, as long as we get up and continue to follow Christ and not give in to the discouragements and the whims that the enemy sends our way, when negative thoughts come in our mind that life is just too hard, we must counterattack. We must raise up a standard in our own hearts and our minds against the attack of the enemy that comes against our minds, and declare what the Word of God says in our life. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. And every tongue that rises up against me in judgment, the Lord said and given me the power and the authority to condemn it. We are definitely living in the times of sorrow that Christ spoke of to his apostles, his disciples. And if you can't see those signs, you need to pray and ask the Lord to open up your spiritual eyes that you may see them, or you're going to miss Him. There is devastation all over our world today. A lot of people are wishing and hoping that the COVID will pass. This is just the beginning, beloved. A couple of weeks ago, the Lord took me back to Exodus when He sent Moses to demand that Pharaoh let his people go. And because Pharaoh's heart was hardened against God, he refused to do that. Matter of fact, he even made their burden even heavier. So God said, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to send signs and plagues. Hallelujah. Yahweh came against the gods of Egypt, against the idols of Pharaoh. And today, those same plagues, but they're different, are going to come. We have seen earthquakes in diverse places. We have seen tsunamis and floods in various places. We have seen fires throughout California in a place that you wouldn't even thought would have happened, but it did. Now we're in the time of diseases, pestilence, what the Word of God, the King James Bible, calls it. And they just had on the news that there is a new outbreak of the COVID-19 in China. Now is the time for us to be serious about the Lord. And stop being tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine. The Bible says in Ephesians, I believe, that Satan is the prince of the power of the air. With different sounds of doctrines, everybody's preaching different things, but they're not preaching the gospel of Yeshua HaMashiach. That there's only one way that we can be saved, and that's through him. I don't know, beloved, the Lord just led me to go this way, to start the class off this way. Hallelujah. But when you come into the presence of the Lord, he says there's fullness of joy. He fills your cup until it overflows. We rest in his arms. We put our head upon his chest that we may hear his heartbeat. What is the Lord's heartbeat? Not only for your life, but for your family's lives, for your friend's life. What is his heartbeat? The Lord is saddened by what is going on because men's hearts has become hardened. Jesus said that it will be like it was in the time of Noah. The earth was so wicked then that God said, my spirit would not always dwell with man. He regretted making man. So he told Noah to prepare an ark. He's telling each one of us on this line that we need to prepare an ark to save our families, those whom we love, that we say that we love. Times are getting evil. There's all kind of propaganda and all kind of false messages going out. But I don't know about you guys. Jesus is my King. He is my Lord. He is my President. I live in a different kingdom, not the kingdom of this world. If somebody could get 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. Also, can someone get Romans chapter 7, verse 17 to 25? And can someone get Ephesians chapter 4 to read 22 through 24? Good afternoon, Zoe and Latasha.
Good afternoon. Zoe's at work.
Oh, okay. Well, praise God. Lord, open the door for her.
grab Romans.
Hi, Stevie.
Okay, Stevie's doing Romans. Who's doing second? I'll do 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. Who's going to do Ephesians chapter 4, verse 22 to 24?
I can do that. What did you say, Ephesians 4, what?
Ephesians 4, verses 22 to 24. Okay, let me read where we left off. We left off last week about the full effects of Adam's sin, what happened, what took place in that fall. That how we, because we were born through the seed of Abraham, of Adam, we have all been made sinners. Today we're going to be talking about the two contending natures. I sent each and every one of you all the lesson. I typed it out for you, my notes that I took. I'm going to try to keep typing them out and sending them to you guys so that you can see exactly what I'm saying and study for yourself. But we're on the topic of the two contending natures. Upon salvation, a new creature with Christ's nature is born within. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17 reads, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. Yet the old man Adam, self-centered nature, the flesh, does not die. The person that has the Romans chapter 7, verse 17 through 25, can you read that?
Okay, Romans chapter 7, verse 17 through 25, reading out of the Amplified. However, it is no longer I who do the deed, but the sin, the principle, which is at home in me and has possession of me. For I know that nothing good dwells within me, that is, my flesh.
Stop right there.
I can.
Stop right there. Paul said, however, nothing good within me, my flesh does no good. So there's nothing good about our flesh. Okay, continue, sweetie.
I can will what is right, but I cannot perform it. I have the intention and urge to do what is right, but no power to carry it out. For I fail to practice the good deeds I desire to do, but the evil deeds that I do not desire to do are what I am ever doing. Now, if I do what I do not desire to do, it is no longer I doing it. It is not myself that acts, but the sin principle which dwells within me, fixed and operating in my soul. For I find it to be a law, rule of action of my being, that when I want to do what is right and good, evil is ever present with me, and I am subject to its insistent demands. For I endorse and delight in the law of God in my inmost self with my new nature.
Read verse 23:2.
But I discern in my bodily members, in the sensitive appetites and wills of the flesh, a different law, rule of action, at war against the law of my mind, my reason, and making me a prisoner to the law of sin that dwells in my bodily organs, in the sensitive appetites and wills of the flesh.
Wow. Paul said that there's two laws working in him. I'm quite sure all of us on this line have experienced that. When we want to do good, for some strange reason, we just miss the mark on that. And this is what Paul is saying. When I want to do good, evil is always present. Talking about that flesh. The flesh has a mind of its own. We were born with that nature. Evil is in our flesh. Unfortunately, he remains very much alive, that flesh. His old ways, his appetites, his habits and desires present, persist, continues, or persist, consider this. For the flesh lusteth against the spirit, and the spirit against the flesh, and these are contrary one to the other, so that you cannot do the things that you would. Read Romans. We've got Romans chapter 7, verse 17. Oh, Stevie read that. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 22.
Okay, that's me. Hold on a second. I got to go back. Let me find it. Okay, I'm reading it out of the TPT.
Okay.
Bible. And that's Ephesians 4:22-24.
Yes.
And he has taught you to let go of the lifestyle of the ancient man, the old self life, which was corrupted by sinful and deceitful desires that spring from delusions. Now it's time to be made new by every revelation that's been given to you, and to be transformed as you embrace the glorious Christ within as your new life and live in union with him. For God has recreated you all over again in his perfect righteousness, and you now belong to him in the realm of true holiness. That's it.
Amen. Amen. That's the Passion version, right?
Yes.
Okay. If you looking at your notes, you got your notes. You notice I had put the flesh lusts against the spirit. And you guys can look up the scriptures concerned that I have up under there, the flesh, Galatians chapter 3 and verse 3, Galatians chapter 5, verses 19 to 21, against and the spirit. Now the word against, the Holy Spirit told me to look up the word against, since this is where the warfare is at. He said, against, in a direction or course opposite to. So the flesh want to take you in a direction or course that's opposite of the will of God. It is hostile. It is in a hostile opposition or resistance. It resists the will of God. It resists what God told you to do. Is going to fight with you. It is contrary to or opposes the will of God for your life. It is in competition with the Holy Spirit that dwells on the inside of you. So there is two contending natures that we have. The born-again believer, the new man that is in Christ Jesus, and then we have that. We still have that old Adamic nature, our flesh. For the flesh and the spirit, for the flesh and the spirit, Galatians chapter 3, verse 3, Galatians chapter 3 and verse 3. Have you suffered so many things in vain? No, wrong verse 3. Are you so foolish, having begun by the Spirit? Are you now being perfected by the flesh? We are not to be perfected by our flesh. The Spirit, who is the regenerated Christ, is life. The flesh is our fallen man, is of sin and death. So what did Christ do on the cross? He came to nail sin and death on the cross. So when we begin, when we receive Christ as Lord, Savior, and King, and identified with his death, we was resurrected to a new man, a new life, a new kingdom. The flesh manifests its nature through a rebellious, self-centered life. What we are dealing with then is a struggle between an established fleshly nature and an emerging new godly nature. We have a battle that's going on in us. Who we yield to will determine who wins. In the life of every believer, that means me, you, and everybody's on this line, in the life of every believer, the mind is the battlefield on which two-dimensional forces contend. The struggle between good and evil involves a battle for control of the mind, heart, and will of humanity, and that's where our soul is. It's contending. It's just like you're playing chess, if any of you know how to play chess. It's a battle between good and evil. The battlefield is our mind. And sometimes, baby, it can become overwhelming. Therefore, it is critical to spiritual growth that the believer be able to discern. While I'm still talking, can somebody look up the word discern? That which stems from the spirit and soul, from that which emanates from his flesh. We need to be able to discern which one is which. Because if we don't, 9 times out of 10, we're going to walk in the flesh. Anybody got that word discern?
Perceive or recognize something. Distinguish someone or something with difficulty by sight or with the other senses.
The very first one, to perceive with the eyes, detect or distinguish. So we need to distinguish and detect, is this my spirit operating? Or is this my flesh? So we need to be able to discern from the spirit or our soul for that which emanates from our flesh. That is to gain the spiritual understanding necessary to comprehend the origin of his thoughts, whether they be spiritual or fleshly. We need to be able to discern that to gain spiritual understanding necessary to comprehend the origin. In other words, where is it coming from? Is this the Holy Spirit's thoughts or is this my flesh talking? We need to be able to determine the two. If not, he will quite naturally mistake the thoughts or emotions of the soul to be the work of the Holy Spirit. Genesis chapter, Galatians chapter 3:3 says, "Are you so foolish?" Paul is talking to the Galatians. Having begun by the Spirit, they began by the Spirit, but then they started to walk in the flesh. Are you now being perfected by the flesh? Our flesh can profit us nothing. The Spirit, who is the resurrected Christ, is of life. The flesh, which is our fallen man, is of sin and death. We should not begin by the Spirit and attempt to be perfected by the flesh. Since we have begun by the Spirit, we should be perfected by the Spirit and having nothing to do with the flesh. Glory to God. We should have nothing to do with the flesh. In Galatians 2:20, the contrast is between Christ and the I. Can somebody get Galatians chapter 2, verse 20?
Chapter 2, verse 20, reading out of the Amplified. I have been crucified with Christ. In him I have shared his conviction, or his crucifixion, sorry. It is no longer I who live, but Christ, the Messiah, lives in me. And the life I now live in the body I live by faith in, by adherence to, and reliance on, and complete trust in, the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself up for me.
Amen. Out of the Passion Translation, it reads, my old identity has been crucified with the Messiah and no longer lives. For the nails of his cross crucified me with him, and now the essence of this law, this new life, is no longer mine. For the Anointed One lives his life through me. We live in union as one. My new life is empowered by the faith of the Son of God, who loves me so much that he gave himself for me and dispenses his life into mine. So when you receive Christ as your Lord, Savior, and King, he actually came in and took up residence with you. He's in you. Hallelujah. Here, the contrast is between the Spirit and the flesh. This indicates that the Spirit is Christ and the flesh is the I in our experience. From chapter 3 to the end of the epistle, the Spirit is Christ in our life experience. In Revelation, it is Christ. In experience, it is the Spirit. Now, the flesh is condemned, for it is written, the flesh will not glory in his presence. The flesh will not glory in his presence. The flesh is the ultimate expression of the fallen tripartite man, which is us. And the Spirit is the ultimate realization of the process triune God. The flesh inclines to keep the law and is tested by the law. The Spirit is received and enjoyed out of faith. God's economy delivers us from the flesh to the Spirit that we may participate in the blessing of the riches of the triune God. This cannot take place by the flesh. keeping the law, but by the Spirit being received out of faith and experienced through faith. Glory to God. Thank you, Father. So in Galatians, everyone turn to Galatians chapter 5, and we're going to start at verse 19. Galatians chapter 5, verse 19, and we're going to discuss about the flesh. What exactly is the flesh? What does that consist of? Our flesh. Our flesh is hideous. Our flesh will get us in trouble with God. And in that area is where we need to gain control and allow the Holy Spirit to deliver us. In Galatians chapter 5, verse 19 to 21 reads, "And the works of the flesh are manifest, which are such things as fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, sorcery, enmities, strife, jealousy, outbursts of anger, factions, divisions, sets, envyings, bouts of drunkenness, carousing, and things like these, of which I tell you beforehand, even as I have said before, that those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God." The works of the flesh, fornication, adultery, fornication, uncleanness, and lasciviousness are of one group concerning evil passions. We see that all the time on TV and movies, even on sitcoms, TV shows. We see it all the time, this particular thing of the flesh. The word lasciviousness means feeling morbid sexual desire or a propensity to lewdness. The synonyms are carnality. It's carnality. The Strong's definition, G766, is lasciviousness, sometimes including other vices. Filthy lasciviousness, wantingness. That's when homosexuality comes in. Unbridled lust, excess, lasciviousness, wantonness, outrageousness, shamelessness, insolent, lacking moral restraint, especially in sexual conduct. You guys okay? Because I know this can be a very sensitive subject.
Yeah, I'm good.
Okay. Deborah, Tasha?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm okay.
Okay. Idolatry. Now, when I looked this word idolatry up, it was very interesting what Watchman Nee had to say about it. Idolatry and sorcery, witchcraft, are of one group concerning demonic worship. Can someone turn to Revelations chapter 21, verse 8? And can someone get chapter 22, verse 15? That's Revelations chapter 21 and verse 8. And then Revelations chapter 22, verse 15.
I have the first one if nobody has it.
Okay. Go on, Stefan.
But as for the cowards and the ignoble, and the contemptible, But as for the cowards and the ignoble, contemptible, and the cravenly,
despicable,
and the cowardly submissive. And as for the unbelieving and faithless, and as for the depraved and defiled with abomination, and as for murderers, and the lewd and adulterous, and the practicers of magic arts, and the
idolaters,
those who give supreme devotion to anyone or anything other than God. And all liars, those who knowingly convey untruth by word or deed, all of these shall have their part in the lake that blazes with fire and brimstone. This is the second death.
That's kind of deep. That's something to think about. He said, but as for the cowards, you know to do the right thing. Hallelujah. But you scared. You scared of what people would think of you. You scared of what people may say about you. The cowardly and the, what word is this? Unbelieving. And the contemptible and the cravenly, lacking in courage, and the cowardly submissive, and as for the unbelieving and faithless, and as for the deprived and defiled with abomination. Homosexuality is abomination to God. Yeah, I said it. That is an abomination to God. It goes against everything that God is. And as for murderers, and for the lewd and adulterous, and the practicers of magic arts, and the idolaters, those who give supreme devotion to anyone or anything other than God. A person can be an idol in your life. A thing can be an idol in your life. Anything or anyone you give more devotion to than God, that is an idol. And all liars, those who knowingly convey untruth by word or deed, all of these shall have their part in the lake that burns with fire and brimstone. This is the second death. Here in Revelation and in Galatians, he's telling you who's going to enter in and who's not. I mean, that's plain and clear. But yet today in our society, we want to put a tuxedo on it. We want to water it down because we're too scared to talk about sin. We're too scared to confront it, to set a brother and a sister free, but instead we allow them, we see them going to the cliff. We see them going the wrong way, and we will not open our mouth and say anything. But when they fall, we sure got our mouth on them, talking about them. You will be held accountable for that. That is part of walking in love. You say you love me, but you too scared to come to me and confront me about something that is totally outside of God's will. You won't even warn me, but you say that you love me. That's what you said. Christ demonstrated his love. He demonstrated from the Garden of Gethsemane all the way to the cross. surely we can demonstrate love. Love is an action word. It is not a noun. It is a verb. Glory to God. Revelations 22:15.
I'll read it. It says, but outside the city are the perverts and those who practice magic, the immoral and the murderers, those who worship idols, and those who are liars, both in word and deed.
Thank you, Latasha. The Amplified says, but without, talking about outside the walls of the kingdom, are the dogs and those who practice sorcery, magic arts, and impurity, the lewd adulterers, and the murderers and idolaters, and everyone who loves and deals in false. Glory to God. He's pointing out who these people are that's not going to enter the kingdom of God. I wouldn't care how good you play your instrument. If you are doing these things, you then already forfeit your entrance into the kingdom of God. You cannot serve God and Satan at the same time. You can't do it. You must make your mind up, make a decision on who are you going to serve. Who are you going to give your alliance to? The believers that have made a decision to give their alliance wholly to Yahweh and Yahweh alone, they are persecuted. We will go through hardships. We will go through things because there's an enemy out there that can't stand us. He hates us, and he wants to trip us up. He wants us to lose the blessings of God. So he sent things your way. He will even use somebody in the church to attack you because they walking in the flesh and don't realize that they walking in the flesh. They think they holier than thou. They think they doing God's will, but you walking in the flesh. The word of God said, ye which are spiritual, restore such a one, considering yourself. Before you go judging that brother, that sister, you better consider yourself, because that same thing that they're doing, you're going to find yourself in and needing somebody to help you in deliverance. There is no little I's and big U's in the kingdom. We're all in this together or we're not at all. In the book of Acts, the beginning of the church, it said that they all had one mind and one purpose. Today in the 21st century, no, there is no one mind. There is no one purpose. Everybody is divided and on their own. I'm going to get mine. Too bad if you don't get yours. We leave the wounded behind. In the armed forces, they are taught not to leave a brother behind. Period. They have made movies off of it. Do not leave the wounded behind. But yet in the body of Christ, we're terrible when it comes to warfare. We see a brother and sister down. Instead of coming alongside and praying with them, praying for them, encouraging them, speaking, the word says speaking psalms and hymns and spiritual song, provoking one another to love. We don't do that. We kick one another to the curb. Thank you, Holy Spirit. I don't even know why I went there, but it needed to be said. These are the things that will keep us out of the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. Next one, we did with idolatry. Okay, I looked it up in the Strong Greek 5331. It's from the Greek word 53:32, medication, pharmacy. That is, by extension, magic, literal or figuratively, sorcery. The fire's definition, the use or the administering of drugs, poisoning, sorcery. Drugs are drugs and medicines considered sorcery. Magical arts, often found in connection with idolatry, fostered by it, is a metaphor of the deception and sedition of idolatry. He says in Revelation 21, but the cowardly and unbelieving and abominable and murderers and fornicators and sorcerers and idolaters and all the false, their part will be in the lake which burns with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. I'm so glad that the Lord delivered me. It took time, but he delivered me from smoking cannabis. That's the correct word for it. It ain't weed. It's called cannabis. It is a naturally growing plant that God created, that man took and abused it and changed it. It's called cannabis, but God delivered me from that. Hallelujah. Because this is an avenue to open your spirit up to the spirit realm. Hallelujah. We have the Holy Spirit to take us into the presence of the Lord. Amen. But he delivered me. He delivered me from a lot of things. He delivered me from fornication. Glory to God. He delivered me from a lot of things. Enmities. The word enmity means strife, jealousy, and outbursts of anger are of one group. Concerning evil moods. Evil moods. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 1 in the Amplified Bible, it says, however, brethren, I could not talk to you as to spiritual men, but as to non-spiritual men of the flesh, in whom the carnal nature predominates, as the mere infants in the new life in Christ, unable to walk yet. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 3, out the Amplified reads, for you are still unspiritual, having the nature of the flesh under the control of ordinary impulses. For as long as there are envying and jealousy and wrangling and factions among you, are you not unspiritual and of the flesh, behaving yourselves after a human standard and like mere unchanged men? Out the Passion Translation, for you are living your lives dominated by the mindset of the flesh. Ask yourselves, is there jealousy among you? Do you compare yourselves with others? Do you quarrel like children and end up taking sides? If so, this proves that you are living your lives centered on yourselves, dominated by the mindset of the flesh and behaving like unbelievers. The world has entered the church because the watchmen came off the wall. Hallelujah. Instead of preaching the gospel, they want to give music fest to draw people in. And still don't end up preaching the gospel. The world has entered the church where women can just dress any old kind of way. I mean, they got it all hanging out, and it's flowing too. Not thinking that maybe if I dress this way, I don't want to provoke my brother into sinning and lusting in his heart. But they got boobs hanging all out. dressed too tight. I mean, you can see it all. That's walking in the flesh. Paul said that we are, as women, to walk, dress moderately. Keep it a secret, my goodness. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14, out the Amplified, it reads, "But the natural, non-spiritual man does not accept or welcome or admit into his heart the gifts and teachings and revelations of the Spirit of God, for they are folly, meaningless, nonsense to him, and he is incapable of knowing them, of progressively recognizing, understanding, and becoming better acquainted with them, because they are spiritually discerned and estimated and appreciated." When it comes to the reading the Bible, beloved, we must read it from our spirit. We cannot read it from our fleshly mind. We have to read it from the spirit. That's why it's so important that we pray before we read God's word. If we read it by the flesh, it would be just another book. Pray and ask God before you read your word. Lord, open your word to me. Help me to see and understand your word. The word of God will come to life for you. But it has to be by faith. Lord, I want to read your word from my spirit man. I want to be taught by your Holy Spirit. And God will cause his word to come to life. I think I told you half of my testimony last time we had talked about me being incarcerated and how she had me read the Bible, St. John. The Bible came alive. For many years as a child, growing up, I would read the Bible. But this time, the word came alive. I was in it. I seen everything. It was woo. It was deep. I would have visions of me sitting at the feet of Jesus and being taught by him. Seeing myself one time at the bottom of the stairs of the great white throne. Totally naked. We are naked before God. We can't hide anything from God. Seeing myself walking in the garden, a new heaven and a new earth with Jesus. Hallelujah. When we're serious about the Lord, he will reveal things to you. He will open. The Bible can be an experience that no one can take from you. Fleshly denotes being made of flesh. Fleshly denotes being influenced by the nature of the flesh and partaking of the character of the flesh. In this verse, the apostle considered the Corinthian believers to be totally of the flesh, to be made of the flesh, and to be just flesh. What a strong word. Then in verse 3, the apostle condemned their behaving in jealousy and strife as fleshly, as being under the influence of their fleshly nature and partaking of the character of the flesh. A soulish man is a natural man, one who allows his soul, including the mind, this is part of your soul, the mind, the emotions, and the will to dominate his entire being, and who lives by his soul, ignoring his spirit, not using his spirit, and even behaving as if he did not even have a spirit. Jude, can somebody get Jude chapter 1, verse 19? Let me see, we're running out of time. Jude chapter 1, verse 19. Can someone get 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 22 and 23? While you're getting, I'm going to read that over again. A soulish man is a natural man, one who allows his soul, including the mind, the emotion, and the will, to dominate his entire being, and who lives by his soul, ignoring his spirit, not using his spirit, and even behaving as if he did not have a spirit. Jude chapter 1, verse 19. Who has that?
I have it.
Okay.
Reading out of the Amplified. It is these who are agitators, setting up incense and causing divisions, merely sensual creatures, carnal, worldly-minded people, devoid of the Holy Spirit and
destitute
of any higher spiritual life.
Wow. He says, creatures, carnal, worldly-minded people, and they're all in the church. The world talks about the church. The world judges the church because of their behavior. They say that Christians are the meanest people you ever meet. No, those are fleshly, soulish people that you are meeting that are in the flesh. But we here on this line, we want to be transformed into the image of Christ, to begin to walk after Christ, walk in his step, be like Christ, have the mind of Christ, not as the world, carnal, worldly Christians. And yes, some of them, yes, they are mean as snakes. Yes, they are. Hallelujah. Such a man does not receive the things of the Spirit of God, and he is not able to know them. He's unable. When you walk in the flesh, you are unable to know the things of God. Rather, he rejects them. The religious Jews who required signs, and the physiological Greeks, who sought wisdom, 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 22, who has that?
I can read it.
Go ahead.
Okay, wait a minute. I got to find it. Okay. I'm doing 22. Okay. For while Jews demandingly ask for signs and miracles, and Greeks pursue philosophy and wisdom, we preach Christ, the Messiah, crucified, preaching which to the Jews is a scandal and an offensive stumbling block that springs a snare or trap.
Uh-huh.
And to the Gentiles, it is absurd and utterly unphilosophical nonsense. I'm having problems with this word.
Philosophical.
There you go.
So there's that two.
That's
finished.
22 and 23.
Okay. There's two contending people that Paul's talking about. You have the Jews, then you have the Greeks with their philosophical intelligence. And y'all heard some of them with them big old jam words. Hey, the apostles, the disciples, they were fishermen. I just discovered that Luke, in the Bible, he wasn't even a disciple. You won't find his name there. But they were fishermen. They were unlearned men. They didn't go to school. They was required as children to go to school to learn about the Torah, to learn about the Ten Commandments, how to live their life and things, but they didn't further that education. They had to make a living. They were unlearned men. God's not looking for the wise. He's not looking for the intelligent. He's looking for somebody that is going to be open and obedient to him. Such were such natural men to whom the things of the Spirit of God were foolishness to them. It was foolishness to them. They could not receive it. The message of the gospel was a stumbling block to the Jews. It was like a drive-by, y'all. They could not comprehend it or understand it. But praise God that the Lord is giving them revelation now, that many of God's people are beginning to receive Christ as their Lord, Savior, and King. Talking about the Jewish people, the people of God. False teaching going on, talking about God and kicked them to the curb. No, God would never leave his people. He went to the Gentiles to provoke them to jealousy. In the end time, when Christ returns, when all things are said and done, Jesus said that he was going to save his people. All of them might not come to Christ, but most majority of them will receive him as Messiah. And that's going on now. They became a stumbling block. Christ was a stumbling block. Christ crucified. He was weak, despised, and rejected, was a stumbling block to the miracle-seeking religious Jews. Today, you have people chasing after miracles and getting caught up in falsehood. I can name a couple of them that's false, whose own children told on them. You have people with itching ears. Oh, they want to follow this prophet. They want to follow this teacher. They want stay your butt in one place and learn from the Holy Ghost. Go to the school of the Holy Ghost. And I mean, they've churches are filled. Joel Osteen, the smiling man. He's just an inspirational speaker. That man ain't even saved. But yet, his whole church is filled. He got thousands of people follow him. T.D. Jakes is another one. Yeah, I said it. Joyce Meyer. It's a lot of them. People seeking after religious miracles and foolishness to the wisdom, seeking for physiological degrees. Yet this Christ was just the one they both needed to solve all their problems dealt with in this book. Let's not become to that place where our hearts are hardened against God and the Word of God. Many people today don't want to even hear the Word of God. They don't even want to have nothing to do with the Word of God. Hallelujah. They deny the power of the crucified Christ. The crucified Christ preached, that was preached by the apostles, and the power of God and the wisdom of God. Wisdom is for planning, purposing. Power is for carrying it out, accomplishing what is planned and purposed in God's economy. Christ is both. He was both. Glory to God. I'm going to leave off here. It's 117 now. Leave off on this last page. We haven't even finished yet, but we're going to finish off on this particular page on, what was it, enmities. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 15 out the Amplified, but the spiritual man tries all things. He examines, investigates, inquires into, questions, and discerns all things. Seek God, beloved. Inquire, investigate, examine. A spiritual man just not gonna, okay, I'm gonna check that out. I'm gonna research it for myself. I'm gonna find it out for myself. I'm gonna question God about it. Yet is himself to be put on trial and judged by no one. He can read the meaning of everything, but no one can properly discern or praise or get an insight into him. Now, that's a safe place, y'all. I remember it was a group of ladies way back in the day that I fellowshiped with. One of them said, Jackie, you got walls around you. They couldn't read me. They was trying to read me. No. Because you have to, in order to read a real spiritual man, you have to be spiritual yourself. Seeking God's face. God will reveal things to you. But a real spiritual man, it said, he cannot be discerned. He would never be properly discerned or praised or get an insight to him. In order, you have to be spiritual. You have to be on that level where he's at. It's usually when a person, when you can't, usually when religious folks try to read you, they judge you. They make judgments because they can't read you. They don't like you because they can't read you. They don't like you and don't want to fellowship with you because they can't have control. Glory to God. We want to be disciples of Jesus Christ. We want to follow after him. Now, a spiritual man is one who does not behave according to the flesh or act according to the soulish life, but lives according to the Spirit. That is, his Spirit mingled with the Spirit of God. Such a man is dominated, governed, directed, moved, and led by such a mingled spirit. A spiritual man is one who denies his soul and does not live by his soul, but allows his spirit, that is, his regenerated spirit, which is accompanied and energized by the Spirit of God, to dominate his entire being. Furthermore, he lives by such a spirit, moving and acting according to it. Romans chapter 8 and verse 4. Romans chapter 8 verse 4 reads, out the Amplified, so that the righteous and just requirements of the law might be fully met in us who live and move not in the ways of the flesh, but in the ways of the Spirit, our lives governed not by the standards and according to the dictates of the flesh, but controlled by the Holy Spirit. Such a spiritual person is able to discern the things of the Spirit of God because his constitutional capacity for spiritual perception is able to manifest its functions. I encourage you, beloved, if you have not read the lesson, because we're going to be on this for a while, I encourage you to read the lesson. Look up the scriptures. If you downloaded the Bible that I sent to you, use that as a studying tool. Take advantage of that. Hallelujah. Because that's where I study from. These are my notes that I write down and I take now that I'm sharing with you. Glory to God. Anyone have any questions, anything they would like to share with the group before we close?
I enjoyed the lesson very much. read through the link that you sent. I went ahead and ran through that. The notes were very nice and explained a whole lot. So I just was tuning in and reading some scriptures and enjoying what I was hearing. So that's what I was doing.
So what did the Holy Spirit speak to you? What did he say to you?
Well, it gave me a better understanding on how to fight, you know, the fleshly manners that I've been, you know, having trouble with. It gave me a better understanding on how to identify, you know, where the urges are coming from, whether they're spiritual or whether they're of the flesh or whether they're from just my soul, just, you know, from going through those notes and trying to decide, you know, how to discern what's what, in a sense. Because when you're hit with these thoughts or these urges, whenever you want to do something good or whenever those bad things come up, sometimes it's hard and you get confused about, you know, is this something I'm supposed to do or is this really bad? You know, because the way society and everything is going, it's hard to figure out, you know, what's right and what's wrong nowadays. So, I mean, it makes it a little easier to decide, well, you know, that's just a fleshly thing because it only happens when I'm doing this or it only happens when I see this or it only happens, you know, during this versus a spiritual, which is there constantly or, you know, all the time. But I don't know. Lucifer has a weird way of trying to trip you up and finding that little tiny niche on where to get you, I guess. So.
Amen. You, Latasha?
No, I don't have any questions.
What did the Spirit say to you?
About the lesson?
Uh-huh.
That I have a lot of work to do on myself. I have a lot I have to work on with me.
Uh-huh. Begin to start confessing to yourself that you are a new creature in Christ Jesus. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Begin to say that to yourself every day. Confess it every day. And you will feel those things that you battle with. Huh?
You said say what to myself every day?
Say to yourself every day, I am a new creature in Christ Jesus. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. That's 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. That's in the lesson. Confess that every day. Before you start doing anything else, you want to confess that. Glory to God.
Okay.
And then the things that you're battling with will get weaker and weaker. Hallelujah. You got to begin to confess who you are. You are a new creature in Christ. That old Tasha, she gone. Tasha, she gone. Tasha, rise up again. Tasha going to have to bury Tasha. Okay, we having a funeral today. I'm a new creature in Christ Jesus. All things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Okay?
Okay.
Deborah.
Yes, ma'am.
Anything that you would like to share or anything the Holy Spirit shared with you?
Well, just the importance of knowing the spirit man and the natural man. You really have to do know that. You do have. It's two natures within you. When you receive Lord, you know, Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, just like you just explained to Tasha, everything does become new. You begin to see things with new eyes. No longer that fleshly eyes. The new eyes are spiritual. So it's just, you know, I'm really enjoying this lesson because it's breaking down why what's going on with that natural man even after you receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. That natural man is still there. you do have to bury it. It no longer exists. Like you said, you're a new creature in Christ. I remember when I first had to acknowledge that when I first got saved. And so when I first started acknowledging it, I was just like, well, I'm a new creature in Christ. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things became new. And I'm telling you, the more I come, every time I went through something, I confessed that scripture over and over. I don't know how many times a day I had to do that. But eventually I realized that when I was saying it, I actually started believing it. So when I started first saying it, it was just words to me of what the scripture was saying. But then I began to understand it. So when I confessed it, I was confessing it with authority. I'm still doing that today. It does every day. We're growing. Perfection will not be reached until we see Jesus face to face. But our goal should be constantly, daily dying to that flesh and getting to know the spiritual. The spiritual is always something new. You'll never reach the very end of getting to know the spiritual. So that's pretty much what I got out of, you know, the lesson today.
Amen. 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 Stefan, can you close us out in prayer?
Yeah, I can do that.
Oh, okay.
I just want to thank the Creator for bringing us together in order to hear these words that need to be heard, in order to get these lessons, to give us the information that we actually need to fight these battles that we're in. I want to thank Yeshua for always being present in our ear to whisper to us when Lucifer and the demons are around and they're crying at us, trying to get us to go the wrong way. I want to thank my family, my sisters, my brothers, my mom, you know, everyone that I know that contributes in a good nature in my life to keep me on that straight, narrow path that is just so, so narrow and hard to walk on. I want to thank my mom for taking the time to use herself as a channel to put these lessons together, to type these things up, to send to us, you know, to get us to read and try and educate ourselves in your word, you know, to be ready when it's time, when you need to do what we need to do. I want to ask that throughout the week you stay with us, you repeat the things that we learn, you know, today.
Thank you, Lord.
We try to confess, you know, every day that we are new creatures, you know, born to try and to fight, you know, to be up there where we need to be. Because at your feet is where I want to sit. That's my end game. That's where my soul, my spirit, my heart, my body, that's where all of me wants to be. So I just pray that that's where you continue to give your effort. Even when I continue to fall and make mistakes, you're always there to forgive and just continue to teach me to fight these battles. And that's what I'm thankful for. And that's what I continue to pray for.
Yeah. Amen. Amen. Well, guys, we're going to pick up on factions next week. I'm going to put a bookmark here where I left off at. On factions next week. Believe it or not, I haven't even finished. This is just half of it that I typed out. There's a whole lot more. And I'm only on the physical copy from Perfecting of the Saints. I'm only on page 3, and it's how many pages this is. It's 10 pages to this, 9 pages to this lesson, and I'm only on page 3. When I study, I have to break down everything to get a clear understanding. So start using that Bible that I sent to you guys, because it has commentary in it. It has links, cross references that would take you all through the Bible. It's hard to find a Bible like that, that have cross references like that, where you could just click on it and the cross reference would pop up, the scripture that is related to that topic. You guys have a beautiful, beautiful rest of your Sabbath day. I actually ordered from Amazon some food, so I don't have to go out. I have to wait until they bring my food for me to go out. It was an awesome experience. So, you know I sound kind of weird right now, but my daughter,